Struggling to make sense of raw logs in Datadog? In this video, we'll master Grok Parsing, one of the most powerful tools for structuring logs and unlocking better insights. However, it may seem quite complex. If you are still confused on how it works and how to get started, stay a bit longer and learn how to get the best out of it. In addition, you'll learn along the way some useful tips, so stay tuned. Let's start with the first parsing example. We will take some Apache logs and extract information step by step. We'll zero in on Apache logs. To start, let's explore the patterns they follow. Here are a few pattern examples. They typically look something like this. I'll grab a couple of these and kick off the Grok parser using some sample log lines. I'll copy one log line, head over to my pipeline in the Team DD class, and add a processor specifically for Apache logs. I'll name it Grok Parser and drop in our first example. I'll also add a second example for variety. This helps ensure our parser can handle different Apache log formats. Let's take a look at the final one. This one's a great fit. It gives us a solid foundation to build on. Now that we have our examples, it's time to define some matching rules to start parsing. As a first step, I'll use .start to match the entire line. Right now, nothing's being parsed yet. Let me show you. I'll pick an Apache log as my source. As you can see, not much is extracted yet. We've got the IP, but the HTTP method and path are missing. So let's jump back into the pipeline and begin crafting our rule. Luckily, there's a built-in matcher for that, %IPv4, which handles it automatically. So I'll use the IPv4 pattern, followed by a dot to continue building the match. Perfect. Datadog now extracts the IPv4 address correctly across all logs. Next, there's a space, a dash, another space, and then a name field. To handle this, I'll head back to the Grok parser options. There are quite a few matches available. This one's pretty simple. It looks like a basic word with letters and maybe a few numbers. So I'll use the word pattern to capture it. Great, it matches across all examples. You can see the name field is now successfully extracted. Next up is something a bit trickier, a date field. So how do we approach parsing it? First, we notice the date is wrapped in square brackets. To handle this, let's check out the date parsing examples. I'll scroll up to the advanced settings section. Perfect, this is exactly what we need. Here we've got several date format examples to choose from. Plenty to help us find a close match. Let's find the one that closely resembles our log format. This one has day, month, year, and ends with a time zone offset. Looks like a match. It uses slashes between day, month, and year, just like our log. So I'll copy this pattern into the parser. Let's test it out. It's not matching yet. Something's likely missing. We got a partial match, but it's not picking up the +0000 time zone. Let's search for an example that includes that part too. This version looks much closer to our log format. Let's use it instead. I'll try adding a space here. Great, it worked. This one includes a Z for the time zone, which is what we need. Now we can close the square bracket and move on to the HTTP method, path, and more. Let's keep going and extract the next fields. We're still working through a space separator here. Next, we hit an opening quote, followed by the HTTP method. We can match that using the HTTP method pattern. Nice, everything matches so far. Then there's a space, and next comes the request path. But Word doesn't work here. It doesn't account for slashes in URLs. So let's check which pattern will handle this better. The best option here is not space. Since URLs don't contain spaces, it's a solid fit. That should handle any path nicely. So I'll go with not space and label it something like HTTP path. And perfect, everything matches again. Next, we've got another space in the HTTP version string. In all our logs, that starts with a backslash. Perfect. That lines up just right. Then we get a number. So I'll use the number pattern here. .http version. After that, we hit the closing quote and two more numbers. The first one's definitely the response code. So I'll use number again and call it HTTP status code. Then there's another number, likely a latency or size value. Perfect, after a colon and a space, there's one more number. I'll label it latency for now, since we're not sure what it is. And just like that, we're done with our first Grok rule. Now that everything matches, I can remove the wildcard to simplify the rule. And as you can see, it still works across all our examples. We've just finished building our Grok parser. Since the logs match our team underscore DD underscore class pipeline, any new ones should now be processed automatically. Let's head over to Log Explorer and refresh. You'll now see fields like HTTP underscore method, path, and version fully extracted. The latency field is also extracted now, coming from that final number. We've also got the name field, which was already available earlier. And that's pretty much it for this log. That one was already being extracted before, just worth pointing out as a reference. We also captured a timestamp. If I want to remap it and make sure it aligns with the default date field, I can use a date remapper processor. If it's still not fully clicking, let's walk through a second example, this time with a fresh log type. Now, we already parsed Apache logs earlier, but Datadog has built-in libraries for those, more robust than our custom one. So instead, let's use a log type that isn't parsed by default. I'll paste in some syslogs. These aren't parsed by default, so they're perfect for hands-on practice. As you can see, no fields have been extracted yet. Let's copy one line and start fresh. We'll set up a new Grok parser and feed in this CIS log sample. Perfect, let's build our parsing rule. Just like before, I'll start with a wildcard pattern to ensure we're matching the whole line. The first part is a number, no need to label it yet if we're unsure what it represents. There's a second number right after. Then comes a space and now a date. I'll look for a helper pattern that matches this timestamp format. I'll use this pattern. It ends with milliseconds, which fits our case. Great. It matches perfectly. Let's lock that in. Date successfully extracted. Looking good so far. Beautiful. Let's keep going. We're now moving into the core fields. This next piece looks like a single word, but it contains a dot, so a standard word won't work. I'll use a more flexible string matcher to handle it and label it generically for now. Then we have a space and a name, easy enough to extract. Followed by a number, possibly an ID or code. I think this is where we're at. Another identifier coming in. I'll extract it as ID, followed by another space. Next is a dash and space. This marks the start of a message block. Let's capture the rest of the log line as sentence or message. It's matching nicely. Now I'll remove the wildcard to simplify the pattern and keep our rejects efficient. Complex rejects can slow down log ingestion and even prevent logs from appearing if the query takes too long. As you can see, all the fields are now extracted. Let's save this parser. From now on, logs in this format will be parsed automatically. Of course, we should clean up field names like number or sentence later for clarity, but this is a great starting point. Heading back to Log Explorer, we should start seeing structured data from these new logs. Now let's take it a step further. Here are a few advanced techniques to help you parse more complex logs, and stay flexible as formats change. We've already covered the basics of Grok parsing, but there's more you can do to really level up your pipeline skills. For example, let's say we've created a parsing rule, and now we have multiple sample logs to test against. We can refine our rule to match all of them. First, let's handle cases where certain patterns don't always show up. For example, what if some logs don't include specific numbers? That mismatch causes the rule to fail, and we lose the entire extraction. So how do we avoid that? One option, wrap the optional part in a non-capturing group and add A to make it optional. This way, Grok will still extract everything else, even if that one field is missing. No errors, just a clean partial match. Alternatively, you can create multiple parsing rules. If the first doesn't match, Datadog will try the next one in order. Great for handling variations. This lets you handle edge cases without overcomplicating a single Grok rule. Now for a more advanced tweak, by default, Grok parses the message attribute. But what if the data you want is in a different field? You can target other attributes. Just specify the field inside the pipeline configuration. And this is where helper rules come in handy. Let's say we have a complex pattern that repeats or becomes hard to read. We can define a helper rule to simplify it and reuse it. Let's create one now. As you can see, helper rules in the documentation are designed to simplify your parsing logic. They make things much easier to manage, especially with repeating patterns. In my example, I'll replace the full date string with a helper reference. So instead of repeating the full pattern, I'll use a helper like %my_date. Right now, it's not matching because I need to update it in both rules, same date format. Let's define the my_date helper rule. Perfect, it all matches again. Now the rule is much more readable, and I can reuse that helper for similar fields throughout my pipelines. If you want to dive deeper, check out all the Grok parsing examples in the documentation. They'll help you level up your parsing even faster. You'll find patterns for everything, from basic dates to complex nested JSON objects. If your logs have stringified JSON, you can extract those too. And yes, you can even fall back to rejects when needed. There are also examples for lists, arrays, and repeated fields. Definitely worth exploring. Plenty of examples are available to help you parse faster and more accurately. Let's wrap up with a few bonus tips to help you build parsing rules even faster. These will save you time and make your pipelines more efficient. If you're working with raw logs and don't want to start from scratch, use the Show Parsing Rule button. It auto-generates a base Grok rule you can customize. This gives you a strong starting point that you can tweak. No need to reinvent the wheel. Another powerful trick. Use the query pipelines, false to find any logs that weren't processed by a pipeline. This is useful even for JSON logs. Sometimes you still want to enrich or transform them further. Ideally, this filter should return zero logs, meaning everything is being parsed correctly. With these examples, you're now ready to parse just about any logs from your applications. Sure, sending JSON is easier, but when the format isn't in your control, Grok gives you the power to make sense of it. If you found this helpful, subscribe for more hands-on Datadog tutorials and log mastery tips. Thanks for watching, and happy monitoring!